Hey friends, you know there's no better place to run your ASP.NET apps than on Azure. At Ignite 2020, we announced several new capabilities to help you migrate and modernize your apps, including those with COM Plus or other operating system dependencies. Gaurav Seth is here to show me what's new in Azure App Service today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman. It's Azure Friday. I'm here with Gaurav. How are you, sir?
Doing good. Enjoying the fall colors in Washington.
Very, very much. I love it when people bring me new toys, and I love App Service because I've recently moved my entire blog and podcast and all of like Hanselman Incorporated into App Service. So you're going to show me even more great features of App Service today.
That's great to know.
Yeah. So tell me, what's new in App Service?
So at Ignite 2020, we announced some very interesting capabilities for Azure App Services. So we basically announced a whole new powerful SKU for Azure App Services. We call it PV3. And in PV3, we are going all the way from 2 cores, 8 gigs to 8 cores, 32 gigs of memory. And the idea is that this SKU should pretty much help most of our enterprise customers, especially around large applications and content management services. And along with the PV3 SKU, we also announced the GA for Windows Container. Now, we also announced a public preview starting November 2020 for ASV3, where we have no stamp fees. And we are also continuously working to improve the adoption experience and also the costing by offering commitment-based discounts for our customers.
That's pretty exciting. Now, ACE is the Azure App Service Environment, App Service Environment, or ACE, right?
Yes. That's the single-tenant environment where you could host your most secure workloads.
Mm-hmm. So you have your own space, and previously there was a stamp fee, and now there is not one. So that's great.
Yes.
And these premium V3s, I'm running my things on a V2. That's the really exciting thing here, where you've got Windows Container support, which is going to allow people to basically take things they used to run on virtual machines and manage the virtual machines and run Windows Update and all that kind of, you know, mental weight of having to deal with a virtual machine just goes away because App Service handles that for you.
Yes. As we all know, App Services is managed services. So look at some simple examples when we say managed services, things like automatic OS patching, or looking at, you know, how do what's my underlying infrastructure. So those kind of routine tasks are pretty much part of our managed services offering. And again, when we say any application today, you are talking about how do I scale on demand. You are talking about who takes care of the load balancer. So again, these are some of the key features that we offer as Azure App Services. And now with this whole offering around Windows Container, we are also lighting up scenarios where you were blocked for maybe say a COM Plus or a custom OS dependency with your .NET application. Now with Windows Container into picture, we light up all of those migration scenarios for you.
That's so great, being unblocked from that, because I know lots of people who might have 10 or 15 applications that they've run in App Service, but those legacy deep operating system dependencies have prevented them to moving to App Service. So then they have that psychic weight of a virtual machine to manage, and now that goes away. And then of course, if they know they're gonna be on App Service for a year or two, that reservations pricing is great.
Absolutely.
All right, let's hear all about the Windows Container GA.
So what we have done with Windows Container, we are basically under the hood, we are doing a Hyper-V virtualization. And now, as I previously mentioned, that there were many use cases that we were seeing with our customers where they were blocked from migrating their .NET web applications to Azure App Services, maybe for a COM Plus dependency. And the best example I can think at this moment is if you have a PDF renderer where you want to maybe export your content as PDF, and behind the scene the PDF renderer is making say a GDI handle call, you're blocked for that, because on Azure App Services we have the whole sandbox environment, and that's where we restrict some of these capabilities. So That's one. And again, when we also understand that to light up the most performant experience for our customers on Windows Container, we also have the new PV3, the most powerful SKU2 date for Azure App Services, where we go all the way up to 8 cores and 32 gigs of RAM. Wow. And again, if you look at the pricing part of PV3 with the whole new reservation pricing, in fact, it works out to be almost 20% cheaper than PV2.
Wow. Better and cheaper. I dig it.
Yes.
All right.
And if I talk about the ACE V3, now, as most of you will be aware, that ACE is App Services Environment, which is our single tenant environment for you to host your secure web applications. And again, the ACE could be external load balanced, or it could even be internally load balanced, where you kind of cut off the access to public internet. Now, again, in ACE V3, the two standout changes, if I talk about, one of them is that we are taking away this whole complexity of, you know, customers managing the whole networking requirements. And also, we are doing away with the stamp fees. So that pretty much reduces your deployment cost by 80%. I mean, that's a significant deal.
Wow. I have to admit that one of the things that had made me not afraid, but maybe just a little bit reticent to jump into app service environments was that virtual networking requirement. It felt a little intimidating to me because I wanted my own space, but I didn't want all the extra stuff. And now I don't have to think about those networking requirements.
Yes. And now what we are doing in ACE V3 is we basically simplify this whole experience for you.
That's
lovely. Care of a lot of these complexities behind the hood.
Very cool. That's exciting.
Yes. And now moving over to some of the cost effectiveness or more, if I say, the more migration options. So again, as I briefly spoke about all the reserved instances, commitment-based discounts that we are bringing in. We are also announcing, as of November, we are also announcing deep discounts around dev test pricing on Azure App Services. Again, that's a big deal for our customers who want to set up their dev test environment on Azure App Services while they begin their whole cloud journey. So again, and for some of our customers who are working with our partners, we again have some enticing .NET migration programs, which is part of the Azure Migration Program, or AMP, as we call it.
Very cool. And that's technical support from actual humans.
Yes.
I like it. Do you have a demo for me?
Yes. So let's straight jump into our demo. And before we get into a demo, so again, just to reiterate the example for a PDF render that I was talking about. So this is my fictitious company. It's under Fabricam, and we are selling auto parts. Now imagine I have already made some purchases. And I go here and I see this order history, and now I need to export to PDF. Now this fails. This fails for the very similar reason that I mentioned, that behind the scene, my PDF renderer is making a GTI handle call, and of course, due to sandbox nature of Azure App Services, that fails. So now what are the options for me when I'm blocked by these kind of scenarios? Simple. I can now look into kind of, if I say, dockerizing or containerizing my web application. So this is the Parts Unlimited is a ASP.NET MVC application. And what I simply do is go to Visual Studio and create a Docker file. That's where my whole containerization journey for my ASP.NET application starts. And again, I am using Visual Studio. You could use VS Code, or you could use a simple notepad if you want to create a Docker file. And if you see, the Docker file again is pretty simple. What I'm saying here is what's my base image that I need to use? What's my working directory? And where do I need to copy the entire output of the code? And Wow. Once I am done with this Docker file, again, what I do very simply here is I go ahead and publish my Docker image into a container registry. And again, I am using Azure Container Registry. You have options to use your own private registry or a Docker Hub. So that option, again, lies with you as a customer, what you wish to use.
That is pretty slick. I love that it's all entirely integrated in Visual Studio there, too.
Oh, yes. It's a very, very seamless experience from Visual Studio. Now, once you have your image published to Azure Container Registry, it's very simple. Just get onto the Azure portal and start your experience by creating a new Windows container web application. How we do that is we select the subscription that I want to create my web application in. I choose a resource group. Of course, I need to give a demo. I need to give a name to my web application. And this time, instead of saying that I need to publish code, I say I will publish a Docker container. And the operating system for my container is Windows. Now, what's the region that I want to publish my web application in? What's the app service plan? Again, just to quickly set context, app service plan is what provides me behind the scene capabilities for infrastructure, for region, and then the type of configurations that light up for my web application. Now, once I have made these selections, I go ahead and choose what's my image source. So now I can either do a quick start or I can do either of these options in terms of container registry. Now, since my image is sitting in an Azure Container Registry, I make a choice for the Azure Container Registry where I published my image. And then I choose, okay, that's my image, parts unlimited. And what's the tag? Now, tag is again a concept. It's more like a version. Every time I publish my container image, I could pretty much give it a new version, or I can simply use a tag called latest. Now, once I'm done, I go ahead, I can set up monitoring, and then eventually I can review and go ahead and click the create button. Now, once I do that, the creation experience starts, and in the interest of time, what I've done, I've already done the whole migration flow here for one of the applications. Mm-hmm. And this is how my application looks like once it's migrated. So now, if I go to container settings, very simply, you see this is exactly the same application that I am seeing here. So I'm using exactly the same image here and the tag. And if you look at the docs, the image is being pulled and it's being published.
Interesting. That makes things pretty easy. Like, I think that some people may have not moved their things to Windows for a number of different reasons, including containers kind of being confusing. But you've been able to do this with a very small Docker file. It's really very basic and move it up very quickly.
If you, again, go back to the Docker file, it's just like four lines. That's it.
Yeah. Yeah, Windows containers are really impressive.
Yes. And the other important call out that I want to make with Windows Container is also the host of networking capabilities that now light up with our Windows Container experience. So first, let's start with the whole VNet integration piece. Now, there will always be a scenario where my Windows Container, or for that matter, even my multi-tenant app, would be talking to a backend, say a SQL database. And for security reasons, I want basically to have the communication between my web application and my databases within my virtual network on Azure. So the VNet integration pretty much lights up the same scenario, where what I just do is I integrate my web application to a virtual network and I have a subnet, and within the subnet, I go ahead and say that I'm going to use service endpoint for Microsoft.SQL, which is basically my Azure SQL behind the scene, and that's it. Now what happens is once this is all wired up, my web application and my database will pretty much communicate to each other within the virtual network that I've defined. And if I go to the database side of the things, I see a very similar setup. So if you see, my database is configured to basically receive traffic from this subnet.
See, what's nice that's about how, this...
Yeah, that's how seamless it is.
Yeah, this is really nice because you're taking that kind of classic Windows app with a backend client server application. You've moved it into the cloud. It maintains all of the characteristics that it used to have as a legacy application. But you're taking something that would have taken us days and days to configure, and you're doing it in Azure in minutes. I remember setting up all of these rules in the firewall to make sure that the SQL Server runs on its own private subnet. But with the power of software-based networking in Azure, it's quite simple.
Exactly, Scott. That's how easy it is to configure VNet connectivity between your web applications and your backend like a database. Now, having said that, there will also be scenarios where you even want to restrict or secure the incoming traffic. So take an example that I basically want to have kind of a global load balancing for my web application. I want to have like a web application firewall configured in front of my web application for all the security reasons. You can again do that simply using Azure Front Door. And as most of us know, Azure Front Door is all about where it not only allows you HTTP-based global load balancing, it also takes care of SSL offloading. It even provides you a layer of caching for your application. And again, this is how seamless and easy it is for us to configure my web application and its integration with Front Door. And once I'm done with this, the final configuration here would be that now I want my web application to receive incoming traffic only from Azure Front Door. I don't want my web application to receive incoming traffic from IP address other than this. And that's where, again, this whole concept of IP ACLing comes into picture. So what I'm saying here is that I've created a new rule where I allow the incoming traffic only from this specific IP address block, which in our case belongs to the Azure Front Door that we have configured. So that's, again, another added layer of security for our web application. And once I'm done with all of these configurations, and I now go and browse the same web application, which is deployed as a Windows container, and now I go and look at my orders and click open and click export. The PDF export happens successfully. So now behind the scene, what's happening is all the complex dependencies that I had, or for example, if I had any other custom OS dependencies that I had, now my web application has access to these capabilities. Now, before I move on, I also want to showcase the new SKU that I was talking about, the whole PV3 SKU. So if you see, it starts all the way from 2 virtual CPUs, 8 gigs of memory, all the way up to 8 virtual CPUs and 32 gigs of memory. So, I mean, this is all the capabilities that we have around the new SKU, which is super powerful and super performant. And again, just remember that with reservation pricing, you also get like super discounts on this SKU.
Very cool. So is this all happening now? Like, are we ready or is this preview?
So the SKUs are already in GA. The Windows container capability is in GA, and Ace V3, we will be starting a public preview in November of 2020.
Fantastic. All right. Well, I'm learning all about how to migrate and modernize my .NET applications on Azure today on Azure Friday. Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it, watch more Azure Friday.